Just when I thought that my career was going quiet, in early 2000, the most wonderful call came in, asking me to perform at the 2000 Summer Olympic Games opening ceremony in Sydney. The idea of stepping onto a stage at the 110,000-seat Stadium Australia that September to perform the new Olympic song, Dare to Dream, with fellow Australian John Farnham, had my heart beating fast. As we got closer to the Olympic Games, I was back in contact with John, who'd been a friend of mine for many years. We were both thrilled to be representing our beloved country, and there was a huge build-up to the main event. I'll never forget arriving for the first time at the enormous empty stadium. That afternoon, as we blocked out our moves on stage, I made John promise to hold my hand as I was coming down the stairs in my high heels. It wasn't about the singing. I felt beyond prepared to perform after so much rehearsal. It was more about my shoes. There, I said it, my shoes. The heels weren't sky high, but they were tall enough, and I felt insecure about walking across that bumpy, freshly painted turf-like surface. It was John's duty to be the Olivia catcher. No matter what happens, I implored him, don't let go of my hand. I can barely walk in these shoes, let alone navigate stairs in them. No problem, Livy, he assured me, grinning in his inimitable fashion. You can count on me. I was thrilled to learn that for the final dress rehearsal the night before the event, we'd have a live audience of 30,000 athletes. It was like a mini performance in itself, and I was nearly as excited as I would be the next day. That night at the dress rehearsal, fully made up and dressed to the nines in a sparkling silver gown made by Lisa Ho, I grabbed John's hand tightly. I made sure my microphone pack was secure at my back and adjusted my earpiece so I could lip-sync the words in an emergency. Everything was in perfect order, and as the massive crowd of 30,000 was allowed to pour into that glorious stadium, I felt ecstatic. John and I sang our way down the stairs, why did I wear those shoes, and then began to cover the long distance through the crowd to finish our song. I walked precariously, somewhat secure in John's protective grip, until a pretty girl spoke to him. He became so distracted that he jerked his hand out of mine abruptly while rushing over to say hello. As if on cue, I tripped and fell. When John saw me in a prone position, splayed out on the turf, he rushed back to help me. We ended up finishing our song, never missing a beat. In case I hadn't been humiliated enough, I later heard him telling fans and onlookers in his thick Aussie accent, sprinkled with laughter, I dropped the blonde like a bag of sparkly shit. Later, he would tone the story down to a sack of potatoes. Oh, God love him. I had to laugh in spite of myself. That was John, an adorable, funny man and one of my favorite singers ever. It made the night quite memorable, and this was only dress rehearsal. Finally, the big night arrived, and it was clear and magical. The gates opened for the opening ceremony, and soon 100,000 people filled every stadium seat, not to mention close to 4 billion television viewers worldwide. The energy was electric, as the greatest athletes in the world were gathered in one place to celebrate this traditional coming together of nations in the country that was my home. My heart began to swell while my nerves were going a mile a minute. You're not nervous. You're excited, I repeated over and over to myself as visions of my 15-year-old self trying to form a little rock band crossed my mind. I was suddenly back in my kitchen telling my mum that I wanted to be a singer. And now here I was, representing my country in a gorgeous long dress with those killer silver heels. I clutched John's strong hand so hard that I'm sure I cut off his circulation. This time he vowed to really not let go, no matter who was distracting him.
Mesdames et messieurs, Olivia Newton-John et John Farnham.
Ladies and gentlemen, Olivia Newton-John and John Farnham.
I opened my mouth to sing the first few words in perfect sync with the voice in my earpiece, and all I could hear was static. Crikey, I can't hear. The transmission is bad, I thought to myself. Obviously, the interference in my ears was my problem alone. I glanced at John, singing away cool as a cucumber. He was fine, which was demonstrated by his easy and confident demeanor. I still made my way down those insanely steep stairs with John, who didn't let me fall this time. I was floating as we sang, hand in hand, cutting through the crowd. Although that horrible static was bombarding my eardrums, I could still hear our voices in the stadium itself, but just a little bit, and on a delay. That only added to the chaos. I couldn't time myself to what the audience was hearing because there was a sound delay and my mouth would be moving out of sync with that sound. This is supposed to be the most amazing moment of my life, I thought, and I'm screwed because I can't hear. Just when I thought it couldn't get any worse, I remembered that the cameraman was about to zoom in for my close-up. All I needed was a billion viewers, give or take a few, watching me sing out of time. It was time to muster all the performance lessons I had under my belt and think on my feet, which were killing me. I turned my head to the side. A strange thing to do when the camera is zooming into your face, but there was no choice because if my lips were moving out of time, even a speck, the close-up would have been a total disaster. They won't understand what I'm doing in the director's booth, I thought, but they will when I get off stage. There was a point when John and I split apart and walked down across the field to sing directly to the athletes. Looking into their young and hopeful eyes, all of the problems of the night seemed to melt away. Many were clicking pictures and reaching out to us. Those hands belonged to dreamers from all over the globe, and the enormity of the moment wasn't lost on me. It's funny how even in a crowd that large, you can look into the eyes of one person and it feels as intimate as performing in a small room. We finished our song in that gigantic stadium, and I couldn't even brace myself for the thunderous applause. With a wave and a smile, we walked calmly into the underground parking lot, which was the wings. I couldn't hear a bloody thing, I told John as soon as we were out of sight of the audience. Neither could I, love, he said, as we walked straight up to his manager, Glenn Wheatley, to find out how badly we'd blown it. Great job, you two, Glenn said. But we couldn't hear a thing, we told him in unison. No problem, he insisted. You were perfect, and the audience loved it. John and I just stared at each other, amazed. No one knew we'd been winging it. In fact, I didn't even know he was struggling and vice versa. It was a golden moment. I understand now that my performance, good, bad, or indifferent, was not the point. I wasn't perfect and it doesn't matter, I thought to myself as I went back to my dressing room to take off my makeup at the end of a very long day. I had just learned a lesson for the ages, something that would stay with me forever. There is no such thing as perfection. If you do the best you can, instant to instant, that's the most perfect a human being can ever be. And without these now hilarious moments, I probably wouldn't have remembered it so clearly.